Psychology in Seattle.
So, Berto, someone, a patron, emailed us to talk about infidelity. She had a lot of questions about infidelity and cheating and all that kind of stuff. And I thought we would answer the questions. And as I was preparing for this episode, I found myself doing kind of a mini deep dive on all the research and really my own clinical experience with infidelity and I guess anecdotal experience with infidelity. I think it is a pretty complicated thing. And I think there's a lot of misconceptions. And so I thought we would do an episode in which we really talked for a while about infidelity. What do you say?
Yeah, actually, the irony is that she was originally going to email a different podcast and then she emailed us.
Yeah. So I want to read her email because I think it illuminates a lot of the concerns that people have about infidelity. It doesn't encapsulate everything, but I thought it'd be a good jumping off point. I'm going to introduce the podcast in a second. I work with two people in my organization. They are having an affair. One woman is married and the other woman is single. It impacts our organization. Their interaction with the whole team can be productive at times and totally absent and withdrawn at other times. It's as if all of us jointly are experiencing the ups and downs of their secretive relationship. It's confusing for me because I really respect her, I really respected her in the past tense, and I would never have pinned her as someone who cheats. And then she has a bunch of questions. Sometimes a partner who has been cheated on still stays in the relationship. Why? Why do some partners knowingly accept that their partner is cheating? If someone cheats, does it mean that they don't have integrity in other areas of their life? Are they more likely to lie or shoplift? If someone cheats once, are they more likely to cheat again? What about the single person in the affair? Is there a future in the relationship for the quote-unquote homewreckers? If they are desperate, if they desperately want a real relationship with this person, do they not worry that this person may also cheat on them in the future? Can you explore the passive-aggressive or punishing behavior by those whose partners cheated on them? Does it really take two to cheat? Do people who have been cheated on deserve more in a divorce settlement? How about cultural expectations? For example, it seems that mistresses are quite common in France, Italy, and India. One of my friends was married and her husband cheated on her for 10 years. She didn't find out he cheated until after the divorce. Apparently, lots of her friends in their social circle all knew about it. Can a woman be completely oblivious to her husband cheating for 10 years? They say sexual harassment is more about power than sex. Is cheating more about power than sex, or is it something else? So I want to answer all these questions, and I want to talk about a lot of other things. I want to get into just defining infidelity. I want to talk about the morality. I want to talk about the prevalence rates, and I'm going to quiz you on what you think the prevalence rates, lifetime, and any particular relationship in a given moment. I'm going to talk about couples therapy. I'm going to talk about the risk factors, what sort of things research has shown that increase the likelihood of someone engaging.
Isn't that that Simon Cowell show, The Risk Factor?
Yeah. I'm also going to perhaps ask you, Berto, if you want to talk about your own urges for infidelity or maybe your own infidelities.
Urges.
And maybe why it happened. And I'm going to ask the listeners as well to, in their minds, as they're listening, think about your own infidelities because many people have. And think about why it happened. And then we're going to get into the attachment styles and why that can lead to infidelity, and also the different types that are associated with different attachment styles. Then we're going to go into all of our questions and we're going to try to answer them. Some of them are actually quite complicated.
This is the 11-hour show, right?
Yeah. So as you can see, my short little episode idea blossomed into a large idea.
Yeah.
This is the Psychology in Seattle podcast. I'm your host, Dr. Kirk Honda. I'm a therapist and a professor. Who are you, Beto?
My name is Humberto Castaneda, and I am an iguana charmer.
This episode is just for patrons of the podcast. So if you're listening to this in your ear holes or watching this on YouTube and you're not a patron on Patreon, then this episode is just going to end right now. And so if you want to get the probably 2 hour, maybe 3 hour deep dive into infidelity that we are going to get into, then you have to become a patron by going to patreon.com. When you become a patron, you will gain access to this episode and hundreds of other episodes that are probably our best episodes that are only available to patrons. So do you want to add anything to that?
I'll just give them the TLDR then so that they can get it for free.
Yeah.
There's no I in cheating. Ha ha.